my favorite things of coming to worship every week is finding out what Felicia, what arrangement Felicia is going to play for us before we worship. Thank you, Dr. Kim. Good morning. Welcome to worship. We're glad you're here. We're glad you're worshiping with us online. Would you please stand up and sing with us, "Your Grace Is Enough." 1, 2, 3, 4. The power to take something that is lifeless and put life into it. Our God, only He can.
Treasures that fade are never enough. Y'all be seated. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, we're grateful for this opportunity to come into this place and sing things that are true. We want to sing these things to each other so we can encourage and instruct each other. But we want to sing these things to ourselves too, because no matter how far we've gone in the faith, we need to remind each other of what is true. There is so much about this world and about the influences of this world that tell us what is not true. And so we need to come in here on the first day of every week and reset so that as we go out into our responsibilities and our stresses and our pressures, that we will have this lingering reminder of the things we sang to each other on Sunday. So thank you, Lord, for this place and this time where we can sing these truths, where we can learn or be reminded of truths from your word, and where we can participate in symbols that get deep into our soul in ways that mere words cannot. And we thank you then for the symbols of baptism and the Lord's Supper, which we're about to take part in. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. As I mentioned in the prayer, this is our Sunday to take part in the Lord's Supper. And in just a moment, these plates will go by you, and you will see a stack of two cups in each holder in the plate. And just take one of those stacks and hold on to it until we all have the elements of the Lord's Supper, and then I'll give you some direction from God's Word for us to take part in the Lord's Supper together. The bottom cup will have a piece of the bread, and the top cup will have some of the juice in it. But now, who may take these elements? In our church, we teach that if you are a believer in the Lord Jesus Christ, you are part of the family of God, and this is a family reunion. This is a family meal. And so if you've placed your faith in Jesus, even if you're not a member of this church, we encourage you, if you wish to take part in the Lord's Supper with us. If you're not yet a believer, if you're still sort of thinking through it and you kind of feel on the outside looking in, the Bible tells us that there is a lot to observe as you watch people observe the Lord's Supper. And so watch this symbol. Listen to the words that we say as we take part in this symbol, and see what it can teach you as somebody who isn't yet a believer. Let's have our deacons come forward and our other helpers come and be ready to distribute the elements of the Lord's Supper. And as I said, as these plates go by you in just a moment, if you're participating, take just one of those stacks and then hold on to it until I get back up here to lead us in taking the elements. Felicia. Thank you. God's word, for I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And the passage continues, "In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me.'" And the passage concludes, "For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes back." In the first Lord's Supper, the first time that Jesus instituted the Lord's Supper, it says they departed singing a hymn. We're not ready to depart yet, but we do want to sing a familiar hymn. Paul, lead us in this.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now blind, but now
Thank you. Be seated, please.
Good morning, and thank you for joining us for worship at Hillcrest. Listen now for some key information on some of our upcoming events. Remember, you can always find more information on these and other Hillcrest happenings online at hillcrest.church/events. Make plans now to take part in the Hillcrest Olympic Games on Sunday, August 27th at 5 p.m. in the Hillcrest Gym. Athletes of all ages are welcome to compete in various one-of-a-kind skill contests. Teams will consist of kids, teens, and adults. This event is open to all Hillcrest members, friends, and family. Don't dare miss this fun night. Donate your old puzzles and board games to help support the Labor of Love Holiday Market. Our book booth was such a success at the Labor of Love Holiday Market last year that we're doing it again. We are collecting all sorts of puzzles and board games. All money collected from the sales of these items will go directly to the youth. Please drop off your items in the box right outside of the church library near the foyer. Thank you in advance for all of your help. Operation Christmas Child is back. Hillcrest will once again be collecting boxes for Operation Christmas Child to share the love of Jesus with children around the globe. We are having a pizza lunch packing party in October, but start gathering your wow items now. For more information, contact Debbie Withnow. Finally, don't forget to fill out the connection card. You'll find it in your bulletin or online. The connection card gives us a chance to know you are with us today, and it gives you a chance to respond to what you've heard. If you attend regularly, just fill in your name and email address. If you're a guest with us today, please complete a connection card and place it in the offering plate at the end of service. As our thanks for doing this, please pick up a copy of our pastor's book, Winning Ways. You'll find it on display at the exit doors. And if you want to know more about placing your faith in Jesus or joining our church, there's a spot on the card for that information too. Thank you for listening. Now, let's continue worshiping as Pastor Tom brings us a very important message.
Well, this is an opportunity for us to continue to study God's word, specifically in the place of Colossians. We started several weeks ago, a verse-by-verse, section-by-section look at Paul's letter to the Christians who lived in the ancient city of Colossae. And today we're going to be, and actually for the next few weeks, we're going to be in the same passage, verses 9 through 15 of Colossians chapter 2, which reads, "For in Christ all the fullness of the deity lives in bodily form, and in Christ you have been brought to fullness. He is the head over every power and authority. In him you are also circumcised with a circumcision not performed by human hands. Your whole self, ruled by the flesh, was put off when you were circumcised by Christ, having been buried with him in baptism, in which you were also raised with him through your faith in the working of God who raised him from the dead. When you were dead in your sins and in the uncircumcision of your flesh, God made you alive with Christ. He forgave us all our sins, having canceled the charge of our legal indebtedness, which stood against us and condemned us. He has taken it away, nailing it to the cross. And having disarmed the powers and authorities, he made a public spectacle of them, triumphing over them by the cross." God bless the reading of his word. I want to talk with you today about the environment. And I'm not talking about the physical environment, although creation care is an important subject for us to look at as Christians. But I want to talk about a different kind of environment. Let's call it the spiritual environment. You live in the physical environment. You eat the food of this planet. You drink the water of this planet. You breathe the air of this planet. You're held to the ground because of the gravity of this planet. But you also live in a spiritual environment. You live with the memory of regrets. You're pulled down by the gravity of self-doubts. You breathe in the toxic air of different fears, real and imagined. But what if I told you that you didn't have to live in that spiritual environment, that there was another spiritual environment that could be your place of occupation? The Bible tells us about this spiritual environment with a little two-word phrase. It is a preposition followed by a proper title, in Christ. In Christ. We are in Jesus just as substantively as we are in the physical environment around us. So now, what exactly does it mean to live in Christ? Did you know that that little phrase and variations of that phrase show up 164 times in the 27 books of the New Testament. In Christ, through Christ, into Christ Jesus, in Him, and so on, 164 times. In 1898, A.T. Pearson wrote a book called In Christ Jesus, and the book was simply an exposition of every place where that phrase or variations of that phrase show up. Speaking of the frequent use of that little phrase, Pearson wrote, "Such repetition and variety must have some intense meaning. When in the Word of God a phrase like this occurs so often and with such manifold applications, it cannot be a matter of accident. There is a deep design. God's Spirit is bringing a truth of the highest importance before us, repeating for the sake of emphasis, compelling even the careless reader to give heed as to some vital teaching." Another man named James Stewart wrote a book called A Man in Christ, and he said this, "We tend to forget that there is no other proper name that could intelligibly stand after and be governed by the word in. We do not speak," he says, "of being in St. Francis or in John Wesley, but we do speak about being in Christ Jesus. And the language started with Jesus himself." We read this in John chapter 15, verse 4. Jesus said, "Live in me, make your home in me, just as I do in you." And then he used the image of a grapevine. In the same way, he said, "In the same way that a branch can't bear grapes by itself, but only by being joined to the vine, you can't bear fruit unless you are joined with me." So it was Jesus who got all this started by saying, using the language, "Live in me." And then the rest of the apostles, especially the apostle Paul, took this and he ran with it, and he went deeper with it than anybody had ever gone before. Now, could it be that we are missing something important if we ignore that phrase, or if we take that phrase for granted? You know, we tend to call ourselves, we like to use the title Christian to refer to ourselves today if we're believers in Jesus. But you know how many times the word Christian shows up in the Bible? Three times. Over and over and over again, 164 times, we are described, we are defined as people who are in Christ. Surely there's something important for us to understand about how the Bible describes us as people who are in Christ, and Christ is in us. And so what I want us to do over not just this Sunday, but the next two Sundays, is I want us to pause in our study through the letter to the Colossians, and I want us to camp out in these seven verses, verses 9 through 15. In fact, I don't want us to just study them on Sunday, the next three Sundays. I'd also like you to read this passage every single day, these seven verses, verses 9 through 15, every single day for the next 2 weeks. So on Monday, either in the morning, first thing, or last thing you do before you go to bed, read verses 9 through 15. And then on Tuesday, read verses 9 through 15. Then on Wednesday, read verses 9 through 15, and on it goes. I'm sure you've discovered this to be the case, that a lot of times when you read anything, but especially when you read the Bible just one time, you capture some of its meaning, but when you read it a second time, you capture even more. And even if you've read that passage 9 times in a row, when you read it a 10th time, you discover something you didn't discover in the first 9 times. And so what I'm encouraging you to do for the next 14 days on your own is to read these verses that I read out loud to you, verses 9 through 15 of Colossians chapter 2, and then come in here every Sunday with me and let's see what these verses have to say to us about living in Christ. Now, we're going to see in these next 3 weeks that these seven verses tell us three things about life in Christ. A life in Christ means a life of fullness, a life of fellowship, and a life of freedom. And so this week we're going to see what these verses have to say to us about a life of fullness. Next week we're going to see what these verses have to say to us about a life of true fellowship. And then the third Sunday we're going to see what these verses have to say to us about a life of freedom living in Christ. Fullness, fellowship, freedom. That's our outline, God willing, for today and the next two Sundays. So, let's look first of all at the first two verses of this passage because they tell us something about fullness in Jesus. In fact, the word fullness shows up in both of the verses, verses 9 and 10. Look at them again. For in Christ Jesus, all the fullness of the deity lives in bodily form. And in Christ, you have been brought into fullness. I want you to circle the two places where the word fullness shows up. It shows up in verse 9, verse 10. In Christ, all the fullness of the deity lives in bodily form. Verse 10, in Christ, you have been brought to fullness. So there are two remarkable statements here about entering into this environment called being in Christ. First of all, in Christ, all the fullness of the deity lives in bodily form. That's the first point of this message, was literally the way the verse reads, verse 9 of Colossians chapter 2. It's an absolutely astonishing phrase. This means that everything you can say about God, you can say about Jesus. He wasn't just a man who was filled with the presence of God. He was the presence of God as he walked on this earth. The Apostle John said the same thing. John chapter 1, verse 1 and verse 14. John chapter 1, verse 1. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God, and the Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. Now, there's a popular notion in our world today. You may have even picked it up if you took some introduction to religion class in college, that said that the idea of a divine Jesus didn't show up until 300 years after Jesus walked the earth. And it showed up in the middle of the 4th century with the Emperor Constantine. It's always that pesky Emperor Constantine that ruined things, according to some people. And the story goes, is that the Emperor Constantine called all the bishops together, and there they invented this understanding of a divine Jesus. Up until that time, Jesus was just sort of some itinerant preacher, kind of a hippie prophet that went around blessing children and smelling flowers, and then all of a sudden he was regarded as divine 300 years after his time on this earth. If that's the way you were taught, if that's the concept that you have in your head, what do you do with verse 9 of Colossians chapter 2? Which was written 300 years before the Emperor Constantine. In fact, it was written within 25 years of the life of Jesus himself. And the Apostle Paul said, in Christ, all the fullness of the deity lives in bodily form. In his book, Paul and the Faithfulness of God, N.T. Wright said, the early Christians, already by the time of Paul, had articulated a belief in the divinity of Jesus far more powerfully and indeed more poetically than anyone has previously imagined. Christians didn't need to wait around until the 4th century to start talking about Jesus as divine. They'd already been talking about Jesus as divine for 300 years. Immediately after Jesus left the scene, when they began preaching, when they began writing about Jesus, they were already talking about him as the divine Son of God. And they did so because this is what Jesus claimed for himself. In John chapter 14, verse 9, he said, anyone who has seen me has seen the Father. Now, this truth is especially relevant for those of you who are trying to figure out if Christianity is for you. You're trying to decide if there's anything to this Jesus thing and this Christianity thing. Let's imagine that a bank sent you a letter telling you that somebody had died and you were the beneficiary of $1 million in that person's will. Now, I'm not talking about you got an email from a sketchy person claiming to be the Nigerian widow, you know, of a Nigerian general. All of us have received things like that. I'm talking about a real letter from a legitimate bank, but the problem is you don't recognize the name of this person who made you his beneficiary. That man's name has never come up in any family reunions. You've never heard of this guy. And so your skeptical side would immediately assume that the bank made a mistake, that there really was somebody out there, or really is somebody out there, who's going to be the beneficiary of $1 million. But it's probably not you. But that word probably makes you think. And maybe you think you probably ought to investigate this. I think you probably would. Now, isn't that a good parallel for what all of us ought to do with the claims of Jesus? Here is this man who came into the world not just to be a guide, not just to give us some intriguing parables, not just to give us a way to live. He came claiming to be the Creator visiting his creation in person. And the very first people to follow him believed that too. And they wrote about it. And they stuck to their guns on this conviction, even to the point of persecution and death. Isn't this evidence worth considering? Isn't this evidence worth looking into? I like the encouragement from the late John Stott, an English pastor and popular author. He said, if you find it hard to believe in God, I strongly advise you to begin your search not with philosophical questions about the existence and being of God, but with Jesus of Nazareth. If you read again the story of Jesus and read it as an honest and humble seeker, Jesus Christ is able to reveal himself to you and thus make God real to you. And when that happens, Jesus, who was and is the fullness of God, brings you into fullness. That's the second thing we discover in this passage. So in verse 9, we read that in Christ all the fullness of the deity lives in bodily form. But then that word fullness shows up again in verse 10. In Christ you have been brought to fullness. John and Marie Barnett were leading worship in their church as they did every Sunday. And after leading the congregation in one particular song, John, who was at the keyboard, continued to kind of improvise and play a bit of a tune, as it allowed people to sort of think through the things they had just been singing together as a congregation. And that's when Marie says that her eyes were closed and she was worshiping and thinking through what had just been sung, and words came to her mind. And she began to spontaneously sing these words, and much to her surprise, the entire congregation started singing along with these words too. This is the air I breathe. This is the air I breathe. Your holy presence living in me. This is my daily bread. This is my daily bread. Your very word spoken to me. And since then, millions of people and thousands of congregations have used that song in their worship music, including this congregation. Because what that song was trying to get across, what that song was trying to say, is that you and I are in Christ, and because of that, we're full, we're fulfilled, and we're satisfied. Why is it important for us to know that Jesus brings us to fullness? It's because knowing that can get us out of the trouble we get ourselves into. We get ourselves in trouble for two things: by going after the wrong things, or by taking the right things and putting them in the wrong place. Very simply, that is a theology of sin that you can write down, and inside of 30 seconds, you get 3 years of seminary right there. This is what sin is. It's doing the wrong things or taking the right things and putting them in the wrong place. And understanding the fullness that Christ brings you into can help you combat those two things that get us into trouble. So think of the wrong things that we choose and continue to choose: pornography and addiction and one-night stands and bitterness and unforgiveness. These things that we choose and we think they're going to satisfy us, they think that this is the way to solve life, and they bring us nothing but heartbreak. The more likely we understand that Jesus brings us fullness, the less appealing these things will be to us. Let me illustrate this. There was a 19th century Russian priest named Father John of Kronstadt, and most of his fellow clergymen of the time, they did not go out and visit in the neighborhoods immediately around their parish, and that was because at that season in Russian history, there was a lot of decay, there was a lot of debauchery morally, and people were making all kinds of bad choices, and because of that, then it would be a vulnerable place for a priest to go. Somebody might exploit them, take advantage of them, beat them up. But Father John was different. He would go out into these areas and into the slums, and maybe he would find somebody lying in the gutter, sleeping off whatever bad choices the guy had made the night before. And Father John would get him seated up, and he would take his hands and put them on either shoulder, and he would say, "This is beneath your dignity. You were made to house the fullness of God." And anywhere Father John went, according to the stories, revival broke out because he simply reminded people of whose they were, and what they were meant to be. They were meant to house the fullness of God. Well, guess what? You and I are meant to be vehicles of the fullness of God as well. And if we understand that, all these lesser things, these cheaper things, these sinful things that we tend to do will become more and more unappealing to us. You know, we have a lot of smart people in this church, a lot of engineers. And if I gave each of you a beaker and said, you know, take all the air out of this beaker, some of you would come up with a complicated process to create a vacuum that could suck out and create negative and suck out all the air that's inside that beaker. But any mama in this place can tell you, because they've been to the school of mamaology, that the way you get air out of a beaker is fill it with water, and air is expelled, right? This is the same when it comes to your life and my life. If we want to empty our lives of that which is disappointing, that which is sinful, the best way to do it is just occupy our lives with the love and the fullness of Jesus. And if we do that, there's simply no room for all of these other poor choices. We need to realize then that the fullness that Christ brings us into can help us battle sin. Now, does that mean we don't need accountability groups? Of course, we still need self-discipline. We need to hold ourselves accountable to other people. We need to be involved in recovery groups and all the types of things that can help us along in this process of killing sin. But we need to recognize what an 18th century preacher once called the expulsive power of a new affection. What he meant was that when we are filled with our love for Jesus and filled with a recognition of Jesus' love for us, it has an expelling power that pushes out all that which is wrong and disappointing in our lives. But now, I said that we get in trouble for two reasons, not just by doing the wrong things, but also by taking the right things and putting them in the wrong place. Anytime that you and I take good things like family and career and nation and wealth and place them at the center, and we interpret that those things as the thing that will really bring us security and stability and happiness, guess what? You've displaced God. And the Bible calls that idolatry. And a lot of us are far more idolatrous than we realize. We realize somewhere along the way, usually in a crisis time, that this is the thing that's now being taken away. That was what we were counting on all along for our stability and self-worth and happiness. But again, if we recognize that we've been brought into fullness, we will be much less likely to be tempted to idolatry. I went to Sam's yesterday. I filled my tank of gas, and after recovering from the dead faint, I left Sam's. And guess what? I didn't go around looking for another place to fill my tank. My tank was full. After I've eaten a big meal, I don't go rummaging around the refrigerator, usually, because I'm full and I don't need anything else to fill me. When you are filled with Christ's love for you and your love for Christ, you don't go looking around for anything else to give you a sense of fulfillment and worth and meaning. Your life is full, and so you don't fall into these idolatries that we so often succumb to. Now, how do we experience this fullness that can change our lives so much? Is there some new technique that we need to do that we're not doing now? Is there some new experience that we need to enter into that we haven't experienced yet? Is there some secret that only a really special teacher can communicate to us? Well, the Apostle Paul would say, none of the above, because it's yours already. I want you to notice the verb tense here in verse 10. He does not say you will be brought to fullness, or you might be brought to fullness, or you can be brought to fullness if the right steps are taken. He says you have been brought into fullness. It's yours already because you belong to Jesus. What we have to do then is we have to live like this is true. Let me illustrate this. I read about two newlyweds who were not very impressed with their honeymoon accommodations. Doug and Sylvia Witt's wedding reception went late into the night, and so when they were finally able to leave that reception, it was the wee hours of the morning when they got to their hotel. Now, they had booked it months earlier on the promise that this was this beautiful honeymoon suite. But when they walked in the door, they saw this tiny little room. It had a table and some chairs around the table. It had a sofa. They found the sofa pulled out to a height of bed. And so they spent this fitful night on this lumpy mattress with sprung springs. And the next day, the newlywed husband went down to the front desk and gave the guy behind the desk a chewing out about these accommodations. And that's when the desk clerk said, "You didn't open the door?" And Doug went back to the room, and he opened what he thought was a closet door. And inside was this spacious room and a king-size bed and a basket full of chocolates and fruits. It was theirs all along. They just didn't take advantage of it. Now, the reality is that this is an illustration of the way a lot of us live the Christian life. We endure in this cramped little room of experience, and we call this Christianity. When all along, there is so much more to the Christian life, and it is described by that little preposition and proper title, in Christ. When you recognize that, you possess what is already yours. You experience it fully as you have never done before. So a life of fullness is already yours to experience. All you have to do is open the door. Keep that in mind as you go through this week, as you deal with the frustrations of raising small children, as you go through the frustrations of driving in Austin traffic, as you wait with some tension for the doctor to interpret the test results for you. Understand that you are in Christ. And because you are in that environment, it makes all the difference in the world. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Now, with heads bowed in prayer and eyes closed, let me remind you that there's more about being in Christ that this passage reveals to us. And we need to take some time to look at it. So read it each day, and then let's study verses 9 through 15 for 3 weeks solid. We're going to discover that life in Christ is true fellowship. Life in Christ is true freedom. But today, we need to commit ourselves to embracing and enjoying fullness. Some of you are not yet believers, and you need to ask the Lord Jesus, the one in whom all the fullness of deity lives in bodily form, you need to ask him to come into your life. He's not just a teacher of moral truths. He is your creator. He is your Lord and God. And you need to say something like this to him: "Dear Jesus, come into my life and be my Savior and Lord. Thank you for dying on the cross for me as my substitute to take away the sin that separates me from your holiness. Come in and clean up my heart and help me understand more about you and how to follow you all the days of my life." But others of us, believing that all the fullness of the deity lives in bodily form in Jesus, we need to recommit ourselves to the truth of that second verse, verse 10. And we need to believe, we need to trust that he has brought us into fullness. And so maybe we need to pray something like this: "Dear Lord, forgive me for giving my relatives, giving my coworkers, giving my neighbors the impression that Christianity is this cramped little room, because that's all I've made of it. But today, what I want to do is live in fullness. I want to open the door. I want to walk into the spaciousness of the fullness that is mine by new birthright. I ask that you would help me to reflect over these truths until I have, in the fullness of Jesus, pushed out all that disappoints you, and I've pushed out all that I have used to replace you as number one in my life. And I recommit myself to living in you and all the experiences I'm going to face this upcoming week." Now, Lord God, we pray that those who've prayed this prayer to receive you, and those who've prayed this prayer to recommit to you, that we will look for how you are answering our prayer request in our lives. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. There's a connection card in your pew rack, and on that connection card you will see a QR code. And so you can use the physical card, or you can point your phone to that QR code. Either way, I want you to get to this connection card. because this is a way for you to let us know that you are attending today. We'd just love to know how to email you or mail you some more information about our church. And as our gift to you, if you'll fill out that card online or the physical card, you can pick up my devotional guide, 40-day devotional guide called Winning Ways, as you exit the door. But this connection card is also a way for you to let us know, you know what, I'm ready to make one of these decisions, or I want to learn a little bit more about making this decision to join up with Jesus or become a member of this church, or to recommit myself to living in Christ. And so if you'll fill out that card and let us know about these commitments or new commitments, we'll be really honored to see what you've got to say to us in those cards. And you can catch me after the service is up and ask me these questions immediately or talk with me immediately about committing to Christ. There's a coffee fellowship after the service is up. It's in between our worship service and our small group time. And I'll be in the gym, and I'll be glad to talk with you about anything that comes up. But a lot of people just like to fill out this connection card, and I hope that you'll do that as well. Let's have our ushers come forward now to receive this morning's offering. Let's get our musicians back up on the stage for this last song. And as they're coming to get into place, we do have a couple of folks who've decided to join up with this church and make it official. They've gone through my Discover Hillcrest class, and I want to introduce them. They are a mother and a daughter. So Jane Bartlett and Angie Shilkett, would you guys stand right now? We want to welcome you as new members to our church. All right. Welcome aboard. All right. Let's go to the Lord in prayer and ask him to lead us in this offertory prayer. John Smith, would you lead us?
Bow with me, please. Father, thank you for yet another day that we can come in here, refresh ourselves with the Word of God, allow us to worship you in song. Father, thank you for this message this morning, and may we just open our eyes to the blessings that you have for us. Open our eyes to the fact that you live within us. You've given yourself for us. We turn away from you, God, often, but you never turn away from us. Thank you for your love. Pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
There is no God like Jehovah. There is no God like Jehovah.